Hello everyone, the objective of this presentation is to introduce you to multi-omics analysis with artificial intelligence approaches, and during this course you have probably already seen several applications of artificial intelligence for different data analysis, for example the analysis of radiomics for cancer diagnosis, and now we will focus essentially on the analysis of omics data. First, we will consider main challenges of machine learning to take into account when we work with omics data, as robustness dealing with limited sample size and data scaling. To illustrate these points, I shall use a real use case of leukemia dataset. And in the second part, I will show you some examples how to train basic linear and nonlinear models for leukemia classification. Please be attentive to this part, because after the presentation you will have a practical session data challenge, and it will be your turn to train algorithm for a very similar problem of lung cancer classification. There are many types of omics data and several specific approaches of machine learning that target particular data types. Today we'll consider transcriptomic data as an example, which measure expression levels of genes, and some classical machine learning approaches that can be used for different omics, not only for transcriptomic, but also for proteomic data, methylation data, and so on. In the literature, you can find some studies that also mix different kind of omics, for example, to realize a joint analysis of transcriptome and methylome together. It is completely possible with artificial intelligence approaches, but a little bit more complicated. Today, we will focus on a simple case. I will use the example of leukemia transcriptomic data recorded with microarray technology. The data are provided by the NCBI-GEO public repository. It contains expression levels for more than 20,000 genes for three leukemia types: chronic lymphocytic leukemia, acute lymphoblastic leukemia, and acute myeloid leukemia. The goal is to predict leukemia type. This type of classification problem is called supervised learning, when we have data and labels for each sample. Now we'll randomly split our total dataset of 1,740 samples in two datasets. We will keep 1,640 samples for training and optimization of our machine learning algorithm, and we will leave out 100 samples for the final evaluation. We can imagine that these 100 samples represent new patients with leukemia for which we should identify their leukemia types. In both training and leave out dataset, we'll keep the same proportion of three leukemia types. During the data challenge, you will have also the same kind of situation. You will be given a training dataset of approximately 500 samples with labels and a final test dataset with 100 samples without labels. You should predict the type of cancer for these new samples, and you will be evaluated on the accuracy of your prediction. Let's first visualize the data with two techniques, a PCA, principal component analysis, and a clustering. On both figures, we can see the same thing. The yellow data points corresponding to chronic lymphocytic leukemia are quite separated from the others. It means that it will be rather simple to identify this class with machine learning techniques. But the two other classes seem to be mixed. It will be probably a little bit more difficult to separate them. When we work with omics data, there are some problems or challenges that we should take into account and to pay special attention to during data analysis. We will discuss here three of them, and we will start with the robustness and generalization problem. It may happen that when we train a classifier, it works very well on the training data set. Unfortunately, it doesn't mean that it will also work well on another independent data set. Globally, we can encounter three kinds of situations. The first figure represents a situation when the model underfits the data. The model here is a straight line, and it doesn't respect very well the nature of the phenomenon, which is obviously non-linear. In this case, the model is underfitted and will not provide good results. In the opposite situation, on the last figure, the model is probably too complicated and it overfits the data. The model fits too closely the points and reproduces the noise. It tends to memorize specific points of noise instead of learning from data. In this case, the model gives excellent results in training dataset, but it will provide poor results in a new dataset with different points. Finally, we search an intermediate situation where the model is sufficiently complex to reproduce the biological phenomenon, but at the same time, it is sufficiently simple to avoid the memorization of noise. The model has good generalization properties because it provides good results in both training and test datasets. Now the question is, how can we know if our model is underfitted, overfitted, or just fine? We can, for example, compare the accuracy obtained with our model in training and in test datasets. The accuracy means how many samples are correctly predicted by the model. If the model is underfitted, it has a poor accuracy in both datasets. When it is overfitted, the prediction in training dataset will be very high, but the accuracy obtained for test dataset will be low. You may notice in this case an important difference between the datasets. Finally, if the model is robust and has good generalization properties, it works well on both datasets, then we expect to obtain similar accuracy rates. They are not necessarily perfect, but the accuracy is stable in different datasets. This is the best expected model for us. We need to estimate the accuracy rates in the data to evaluate if our model is robust. How to do this? At this stage, to optimize the model, we are allowed to use only the training dataset. A classical approach and a good practice is to do a cross-validation. The cross-validation consists in splitting the initial training dataset in several parts. Here we split in three parts. The split is random, and we use two parts for training and one part for test. Then we permute the training and test parts. For threefold cross-validation presented in this example, we will have three permutations. Therefore, we can measure the accuracy in training and test datasets three times and to calculate average accuracy. I strongly recommend you to do a cross-validation during your practical session. If you are limited in time, you can at least split the initial training dataset in two parts, training and test, to be able to estimate the performance of your model. During the data challenge, you can use any programming language or tool that you want, for example, R or Python. I personally use Python with a famous framework for machine learning named scikit-learn. So here in the presentation, I'll leave you an example of code with Python to perform a cross-validation with three splits. If you also use Python, you may check it. Scikit-learn contains by default many types of cross-validations that are ready to use. First, we need to create an instance of a cross-validation and to indicate the number of faults or number of splits as a parameter. Here I choose a three-fold stratified cross-validation, which preserves the proportions of labels in each dataset, training and test. Then we use the method split to randomly split the initial dataset X into training and test datasets. With a for loop, we then consequently access three iterations. Each iteration corresponds to one possible permutation. Now let's talk about the second problem or challenge that we often encounter with omics data analysis. In omics data, the number of samples is usually much less than the number of model parameters, the number of genes in our case. The difference in sizes may be very important, more than 10 times. In theory, we can train a mathematically correct model only if the number of parameters is less or equal to the number of samples. Otherwise, the data are insufficient to properly constrain the model. The problem is ill-posed, and we may obtain an infinite number of solutions, which in addition are not real solutions, but may be the artifacts. Usually the model is strongly overfitted in this case. The difficulty is that we don't have enough data, enough information to constrain all the parameters of our model. There are several approaches to resolve or at least to reduce this problem. First, we can simplify the model by reducing the number of parameters. For example, we can select only a few parameters. The immediate question will be how to select these parameters, and we need to answer this question later. We can also combine parameters to reduce their total number, for example, to use the most important principal components of the PCA. A second possibility would be to add somehow a supplementary information to our model. For example, we can add constraints on the model behavior by accepting linear solutions only, or to add a regularization to control the smoothness of the model, and sometimes to reduce the number of parameters in the same time. Finally, there are also specific approaches for neural networks that help to avoid memorization of the data during the learning process, for example, dropouts and early stopping techniques. In our simple case, I propose you to reduce the number of parameters using variance. The main idea here is to select only genes with an important variation in expression level across samples. In the first approximation, we can speculate that if the expression level of a gene is the same for all the samples, then probably this gene is less useful for prediction. It's not always true, but we can accept this idea for our example. So we select the genes with high variance. How many genes we should select? Well, it's a rather difficult question. It strongly depends on data and on used model. Here we can empirically consider a good number of genes to be roughly 1/3 of the number of samples, approximately 500 genes. Now, if we visualize data using selected genes only, we may notice that the separation between groups is a little better. It is even more visible on clustering images. The groups of leukemia are much better separated when we reduce the noise. The reduction of parameters by variance is not a unique strategy. We can apply other approaches. For example, instead of calculating variance across samples, we can also select genes with important variation in expression levels across groups, as presented on the first figure. This gene seems to be interesting for classification. On the second figure, the expression levels are almost the same for all groups. Thus, this gene is probably less interesting for classification. Formally, it can be done by statistical test, t-test or ANOVA in groups, selecting genes with low p-values. Sometimes we can introduce a threshold for noise and to select only genes with expression levels above this threshold. Another very popular method for parameter reduction is to use an output of a linear model. In this case, we first train a linear model, for example, logistic regression, using all the parameters, probably with a regularization. And then we select only the parameters which are most important for prediction according to this linear model. And finally, the selected parameters may be used to train a more accurate non-linear model. The last point or challenge that we talk about will be the data scaling. In omics data, the parameters have usually different scales. This may result in a poor convergence for machine learning methods. So we need to scale data before training any machine learning algorithm. Here is a basic technique to scale data by centering and reducing. First, we use a training data set only to measure the mean and standard deviation across samples for each gene separately. Then we calculate a scaled value of expression by removing the mean and by dividing by the standard deviation in both training and test data sets. For test dataset, we don't recalculate the mean and standard deviation, we use those obtained in the training dataset, otherwise the data point will be shifted. And also it's important not to use the entire dataset to calculate the mean and standard deviation, but the training dataset only, otherwise we introduce a leakage of information. So be careful with the scaling and do it properly. In Python, scaling is very simple. We first need to create a scaler. Then the scaler automatically fits the training dataset. Finally, we apply the transformation to both training and test datasets. We understand now the essential points for omics data preparation. Let's create the entire pipeline. Initially, we have a training dataset for model training and a leave-out dataset for which we should predict the levels. To be able to train and to optimize the classifier, let's split the initial training dataset one more time with a cross-validation or just a simple split to create internal training and test datasets. This will be necessary to evaluate the performance of our classifier. In the next step, we can reduce the number of parameters if necessary. Remember that the parameter reduction should be done on the training dataset only. If we are inside the cross-validation, then we use a training dataset of the cross-validation, different at each iteration. Later, when our model is completely established, then we will retrain the model on the initial training dataset without cross-validations, and at this time, we will need to perform a new variable reduction. The final step in our pipeline is the data scaling. the mean and standard deviation are also measured in the training data set only. If we are inside the cross-validation, then the data scaling should be repeated for each iteration. For the final training, we will perform a data scaling on the initial training data set. Let's return now to the example of leukemia data set and let's train some classifiers for leukemia type prediction. The first classifier that I would like to show you is a logistic regression. The classical logistic regression is designed to classify samples between two groups only, but we can easily extend the method for several groups. How it works? Let's imagine that we need to detect samples of acute myeloid leukemia against other types. We use samples from a training dataset. Samples of acute myeloid leukemia are presented in red color. For these points, the probability to be acute myeloid leukemia is equal to 1. The probability is shown on y-axis and the expression level on x-axis. In our example, we imagine that the expression level of acute myeloid leukemia is rather high compared to other leukemia types, which are presented in blue. For these blue samples, the probability to be acute myeloid leukemia is equal to 0. In the logistic regression, we use a mathematical function called logistic function or C-shaped curve or also sigmoid function. Training a logistic regression consists to fit this particular analytical function to our data. It means that we need to optimize the position of the function and its curvature. For example, we can shift the function to the right or to the left or change its slope in order to minimize the residuals between the curve and the real data points. When the curve is correctly placed, then we can proceed to predictions on new samples. For a new sample, we project the expression level of the sample on the logistic curve. The corresponding value on y-axis will give us the probability for the sample to be acute myeloid leukemia. In this case, the probability is equal to 80%. Usually, we put a threshold between groups at 50%. All samples above 50% of probability will be classified as acute myeloid leukemia. The logistic regression for multiple classes is very similar. We train a separate logistic regression for each class against others, and we compare the obtained probabilities and we select the class with the highest probability as a final prediction. Training logistic regression in Python is rather straightforward. First, we create a classifier, logistic regression, with some options. Especially, we need to precise that our data have more than two classes, with multi-class option equal to multinomial. We don't use here any regularization, either rich, less so, or elastic net. Therefore, the regularization, which is also called penalization, is set to noun. A regularization is usually applied to better constrain the model and to avoid possible overfitting. It's a very common technique, a good practice, so common now that it's included by default in almost all the classifiers in scikit-learn framework. If you don't want to use it, then we need to explicitly precise it in options. The last option, solver, indicates which numerical method should be used to minimize residuals to fit the logistic curve to the data points. Many solvers are available in scikit-learn. Here I choose Newton conjugate gradient method. Next, we train the classifier with fit method on the training dataset, which has been already scaled. Then we can predict labels for new samples using predict method on the test dataset. Finally, we can calculate the prediction accuracy comparing real labels with predicted labels on the test dataset. One of the advantages to use a dedicated framework as scikit-learn is that all the classifiers implement the same interface. It means that all the classifiers will have fit and predict methods. Therefore, if we want to change the classifier, for example, to use a neural network instead of the logistic regression, we need to change only one line in our code, just the line where we create the classifier. We don't need to change the rest of the code. The other lines will work perfectly independently on the selected classifier. This is the prediction accuracy obtained by logistic regression on leukemia dataset. As you can see, we can calculate the accuracy in training dataset, in test dataset, and in leave-out dataset. The results in training and test datasets correspond to a cross-validation in our pipeline. Inside the cross-validation, we train the logistic regression on a training dataset and then we test it on a test dataset for each iteration, in total 3 times. we calculate three values of accuracy corresponding to each iteration of cross-validation, and then we plot the average values. On the figure, we can see that the accuracy in training dataset is always perfect, 100%, for all the three iterations. In test datasets, the accuracy changes slightly. In average, we obtain 98.6%. These values allow us to evaluate the performance of our model. We have a very slight overfitting because the accuracy in training dataset is a little bit higher than in test dataset. Nevertheless, the difference is really small, so we can accept it. In the last step, we retrain the logistic regression on the entire initial training dataset, and then we apply it to leave out dataset for final prediction. As expected, we currently predict 98% of samples. It means that the prediction fails for two samples. It can be interesting to see where the prediction failed. This figure shows a principal component analysis for the leave-out dataset. We have 100 samples in total in this dataset. The crosses show where we have a bad prediction. The cross on a blue point means that the real sample is acute lymphoblastic leukemia, while our prediction classified it in acute myeloid leukemia. The situation is just opposite for the second error. The cross on a red point means that the real sample is acute myeloid leukemia, but we predicted it as acute lymphoblastic leukemia. As we can see, both errors are placed near the boundary between two classes. It's a little bit difficult for our classifier. For the third class, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, the prediction is just perfect. This class is well separated from the others and our classifier performs very well. Another widely used classifier that I would like to show you is called support vector machine or SVM. This classifier is linear in its classical form, but it may also perform a non-linear classification. How it works? The SVM method tries to place a boundary between two or more classes. In a general case, there are many solutions to put such a boundary, just to put a straight line. But the SVM method feeds the data to find a unique boundary that maximizes a margin between the boundary and a few closest samples of each class. These closest samples are called support vectors. That's why the name of the method is support vector machine. When a boundary is defined from the training dataset, then a new sample can be easily classified depending where it's placed with respect to the boundary. The results obtained with the linear SVM method for our leukemia dataset are very similar to those of the logistic regression, so I don't show here these results. It's more interesting for us to try a non-linear version of the SVM method to see if we can improve the prediction. The SVM method can perform a non-linear classification if we use a kernel trick. It's a modified version of the method. A kernel allows us to bend the boundary, which will be no more a straight line, but can take different forms. For example, with RBF kernel, RBF means radial basis function, we can achieve more rounded shapes of the boundary. Let's use it in our example. But other kernels are also available and different shapes are possible. To train the SVM classifier with RBF kernel, we need to choose two hyperparameters. The first parameter, C, controls the degree of regularization to avoid overfitting. As we already discussed, the regularization is a good practice and it is included by default in scikit-learn for many classifiers. For the SVM method, we will use a standard ridge regularization. The second parameter, gamma, controls how strong we bend the boundary while using kernel. Do we need a very rounded shape of the boundary or almost a straight line? At this stage, we don't know what values to put for these parameters. We don't know what values are appropriate for our problem and for our dataset. When the dataset is not very big, as in our case, we can try a so-called grid search for hyperparameters. It means that we just try several values for each hyperparameter and see which values are optimal. In this example, I tried 10 different values for the parameter C and 6 values for the parameter gamma. For each couple of parameters, I train the model and then I measure its mean accuracy in test datasets using cross-validation. We can see that for some parameters, the accuracy is poor, essentially when gamma is high. The accuracy in this case is only 43%. It means that the shape of the boundary is bended too strongly and doesn't fit the data well. On the contrary, for other parameters, we obtain a good prediction accuracy. Finally, we can select a pair of hyperparameters that gives the best possible accuracy in test datasets. Now, let's see how our model performs. We obtain the accuracy of 100% in the training dataset and the accuracy of almost 99% in the test dataset. In the live-out dataset, we are able to correctly predict all the samples except one. Yes, the nonlinear SVM model performs a little bit better than the logistic regression. We gain it 1 point. Of course, the difference is not huge because the logistic regression performed already very well, but this new nonlinear model seems to be even better. Nowadays, neural networks, deep learning are very popular in data analysis and in precision oncology in particular. It could be interesting to train a neural network for our leukemia classification use case and to compare with other methods. I will introduce here the main idea of a basic neural network. If you need more details, please check the excellent MIT course Introduction to Deep Learning, publicly available on YouTube. Highly recommended. I will use some slides of this course to briefly explain what a neural network is. A classical neural network is composed of several interconnected artificial neurons, which are called perceptrons. The concept of a perceptron is rather simple. It's similar to a logistic regression. On the figure X1, X2, XM represent expression levels for genes 1, 2, M, and a bias. In the first step, we calculate the weighted sum of all the expression levels. We obtain as a sum just one value. In the second step, we apply an activation function on the sum. For example, the activation function could be the sigmoid function that we have already seen in the logistic regression, and that allows us to transform the sum of expression levels to a probability. For example, the probability that the sample is acute myeloid leukemia. If we use the sigmoid activation function, we obtain exactly a logistic regression. The mathematical formula will be the same, but in the case of a perceptron, it's possible to choose other activation functions, not only the sigmoid function. We can say that a perceptron represents a generalization of the logistic regression. We would like to create a neural network with building blocks, which are perceptrons. For this purpose, we should put several perceptrons in communication. How to achieve this? On this figure, we can see a single perceptron with a simplified representation. It is the same as on the previous slide, just in a more compact representation. This perceptron has a single output. Let's add a second output. This figure corresponds to two logistic regressions, which are trained separately. For example, the first output could correspond to the probability for a sample to be acute myeloid leukemia, and the second output to acute lymphocytic leukemia. For the moment, the outputs are not interconnected. We can now interconnect outputs to obtain a full nonlinear neural network. More precisely, we deal here with a simple classical architecture of neural networks, which is called a multi-layer perceptron. It exists many other architectures that aim different problems. In a neural network, we usually have several internal layers that are called hidden layers. We have also inputs, which are initial expression levels, and outputs, which are, for example, probabilities of different types of leukemia. We can increase the number of hidden layers. The number of nodes in each hidden layer could be different. In this example, we have two hidden layers with four nodes in each, but it could be, for example, 10 nodes in the first hidden layer and 20 nodes in the second hidden layer. Of course, the number of hidden layers can be much more important. In scikit-learn, we can train easily a multi-layer perceptron as any other classifier. We just need to replace the line where we create a classifier. Here we can create a multi-layer perceptron with some parameters. I use the early stopping technique to avoid memorization of data and to avoid overfitting. Our neural network will have four hidden layers with 100 nodes in each layer. And we will use a ridge regularization controlled by the parameter alpha. The other lines in the code are exactly the same as for previous classifiers, a logistic regression or SVM. Here are the results obtained with this neural network on leukemia dataset. As for the SVM model, we predict correctly almost all the samples in the leave-out dataset except one. Nevertheless, this model is preferable to the previous SVM model because the overfitting here is low. The accuracies in the training and test dataset are very close, as you can see. Still, the prediction fails on the same point in the leave-out dataset. With real-life datasets, we can barely expect a perfect prediction, 100% in all the cases. So, this result is very satisfactory. To conclude, we learned today that the analysis of omics data with artificial intelligence approaches may be challenging. In the first challenge is that the results obtained in one study may potentially not be confirmed in another one due to possible overfitting problem. Therefore, when we train an AI algorithm, we need to pay special attention to overfitting in order to obtain robust results. A cross-validation would be a good practice in this situation. Then we consider it a problem related to a very important number of parameters in omics data compared to a relatively small number of samples. This problem may also result in artifacts and overfitting. We have seen that many possible solutions are available, for example, selection of parameters or regularization techniques. We also learned that the data should be scaled, otherwise some machine learning algorithms may not converge very well. And finally, we saw some examples how to train linear and non-linear models for leukemia classification and how to choose hyperparameters with a grid search. So thank you for your attention and good luck with your projects.